So today we will be doing Andromeda. And my name is Cafele. And we're doing the unknown galaxy. Okay. Welcome to our PowerPoint presentation. We'd like to thank you for coming out here. And we decided to do Andromeda because it's the closest galaxy that we can see. And we are interested to see like what's there and investigate. So first we're going to start out with what's a galaxy, what is Andromeda, who discovered it, and when Andromeda and the Milky Way collided, and did you know? A body of stars and planets and dust in them come together and it makes a galaxy, like Andromeda. There's different types. And it's like irregular, spiral, and ecliptic, and Andromeda is a spiral. Andromeda is the closest spiral galaxy. It's like 2.5 light years away, so that's 2.5 million light years. So the light could be gone by now. We don't know though, because the light hasn't traveled through. So, that's an interesting fact. Alba is an Arabic Jew. We couldn't really pronounce his name. It's hard to pronounce his name. Like, Allah Rahman Al-Shuf. He was born on December 7th, 1903. 903. He was a Persian. And one of those nine famous Muslim astronomers that we know. One day he was observing Andromeda and he discovered it. Coming soon.
Did you have a chance to see Andromeda?
Dark, and that's why
theme of the trio is the underworld. An 11-year-old girl named Pluto is found in the Kuiper Belt, which is beyond the orbit of Neptune. And it takes at least 248 years to revolve around the sun. And it, like, then in 2006, scientists came up with a better technology to see the rotation period of Pluto, and it is less than, it's greater than 6 days. But it is also called an unusual body because you can actually see the orbital plane out here. It's different from all the other planets, which is going in different directions, basically 17 degrees more than any other orbital plane. So it's called an unusual body. And then with this explanation, scientists actually named it a dwarf planet in 2006. And it is also called a strange body because this image is basically showing Pluto orbiting around the sun. And when it's like farthest from the sun, it's farther than Neptune. But when it's closer to the sun, it's closer than that of the Neptune's orbital plane. So it's kind of a strange body. And then we're talking about surface and temperature of Pluto.
So Pluto's surface, it looks like a mid-gravity material and it's like ice. And
it's basically a cold planet. It's not that hot because it's farther from the sun than any other planet, and then its atmosphere is like really thin, and there are gases like methane, nitrogen, and carbon monoxide found in Pluto. And then
In 1989, Pluto was at its closest point to the sun. It was warm enough so that the methane on the body was in a gaseous state. However, as Pluto's farther away from the sun, it will become colder by the year 2020. So, Pluto will become much colder, and like the methane, that will freeze, and methane,
and it will form a layer of ice on the surface of Pluto. And that's why Pluto is said to have a partial atmosphere.
For the satellites, there are five. Number one is Charon, two, Nix, three, Hydra, and four, P4, P5. And so Charon is one of the largest, is the largest one. It is too big to relate, it's too big. planet in relation to Pluto. Its diameter is 746 miles, which is more than half the diameter of Pluto. Charon is only 12,200 miles away from Pluto. No other moon in this solar system is as large as the relation, as close in relation to the body of it orbits.
And like two pictures are showing compared to the Earth and the moon and Pluto and the moon Charon. And this is Pluto and the moon Charon.
So, Mintz and Hydra, they were both discovered on May 15, 2005, and Nix was named...
Nix was named after the bodies of darkness and night, because they are basically protecting the planet Pluto, which is dark, and it was named after the god of underworld. And Hydra, it is named after the terrifying monster with nine heads, and the heads are like a serpent. So all this, these four moons were discovered later when the advancement of technology hit. And P4 and P5 are the Chinese moon, Pluto. And P4 and P5 actually got their names approved yesterday. So Calibers is P4.
NASA's New Horizons will be the first spacecraft to visit Pluto on the Kuiper Belt. The spacecraft's journey begins in January 2006. It will continue into the Kuiper Belt after its Pluto flyby in 2015.
All right. So when Pluto goes into Uranus's orbit or Neptune's orbit, do they ever collide?
They don't exactly go into their orbit. They're basically like.
Thank you. Venus is the second planet from the sun. It's it's named Earth. It's similar to Earth, and it's named by it's like Earth's sister planet. It's called Earth's sister planet because it's like similar in size. And it's named after Aphrodite, the goddess of love.
Venus is very hot because the greenhouse effect is having a Venus. A Venus effect is the atmosphere. It's light and use the atmosphere that is up to the surface of the planet. I'm trying to say. And Venus is called Earth's planet because not only is it similar in size, also similar in geological features. Venus also has craters, volcanoes, and the Earth does.
The atmosphere on Venus is hot and thick, and you want to be able to survive in this. The temperature of Venus would burn you, and it's hot enough to melt lead at 800 degrees
Fahrenheit.
Carbon dioxide is the main substance of Venus.
I mentioned earlier in the presentation that Earth and Venus are similar. They also have similar mass, density, composition. But it seems like they have similar gravity, but Venus' gravitational is stronger.
Earth and Venus are both rocky planets, which are between the sun and Venus.
Okay, these pictures, this picture in the corner shows when Venus. Yep, you just hope that when the atmosphere to the crust metal and the core. In this picture here, the first satellite of Venus, look at the merger too. Shot in August 17th, 1962.
Additional
information,
the air full of eggs.
Because the amount of sulfur on the surface of Venus.
It is the hottest planet in the solar system.
Even though Venus is the same planet, even though Mercury is the first, Venus is actually warmer than Mercury. It's almost hard to believe.
And the air on Venus is too toxic for anyone.
Yeah. It's possible a new star or Venus can live on there. But I'm not so certain on that.
Thanks for listening. Good luck. Any questions?
Yes. Yes, so you said that Venus and Earth have similar benefits. Is that temperature Venus?
Possible.
Mark has a question?
Okay.
Yes.
Oh, What was something you learned about Venus that really just surprised you? You didn't know, had any idea about?
That
star. Oh my goodness.
That Venus has a planet, a solar system. You thought Mercury was.
Yeah. Did you get a chance to see it?
Not really. I just remember as we just come out in the daytime, hard to see.
Okay, any other questions for our... All right, excellent. Thank you very much.
Today about the magnitude of stars. Magnitude is defined as the brightness of a celestial object. Magnitude was first used by Hipparchus in ancient Greece. He set the basis of the apparent magnitude scale that we use today. His scale included six classes. Zero was the brightest and six was the dimmest. Our scale today is more accurate using cameras instead of just our eyes. We even have absolute magnitude, which is more accurate when comparing brightness. And this picture here is Hipparchus. Hipparchus' scale is known today as apparent magnitude. It is the relative brightness of objects as seen from Earth. Absolute magnitude is the brightness of stars as compared from a constant distance of 10 parsecs, or 32.6 light years away. Both magnitude scales are based off the brightness of Vega, which was originally defined as zero on both scales. Now, however, with more accurate telescopes and cameras, Vega is no longer exactly zero. This shows Vega in its position on the southern, in the summer triangle. These are some apparent magnitude values of common objects seen in the night sky. As you can see, our eyes cannot see anything past 6 here. And the scale now includes objects fainter than the human eye can see. The Hubble's telescope has been able to pick up objects that are 30 magnitude, which is about a trillion times fainter than Vega. Since Hipparchus, the apparent magnitude scale has grown into the megaliths to include objects that are brighter than Vega. The Sun ranks as the brightest object on the apparent magnitude scale at negative 27. This picture compares the apparent magnitude of that to the absolute magnitude of Canis Major. As you can see, Sirius is the brightest visible star in the constellation, but is actually the dimmest if you compare them from a constant distance. Because Sirius is actually closer to us than some of these other stars, but the other stars are brighter. Here are some absolute magnitude values, and I have added the apparent magnitude values so you can see them in the pairing. Remember that the negative values are brighter than the positive values. And the Sun has the biggest difference. It is actually 4.8 on the absolute scale, but on the apparent scale it's negative 27 because it is so close to us. And so actually it would be the faintest star out of the ones that I have here. Some stars appear to have a variation in their brightness. This is a result of the expansion and contraction in those stars. The changes in brightness can be very slight, or even 8 points, you know, on the magnitude scale, different. Some variable stars include Polaris, Betelgeuse, and even Vega, which has a very slight difference. Another type of variable star is called a second variable. It was an important discovery that led to the creation of absolute magnitude. These variable stars have consistent increases and decreases, as seen on this picture here, that allow scientists to calculate the distance they are away from us. Because they can use the brightness here and the period of how they change to calculate distances. And the separate variables in other galaxies can help us determine the distance to those other galaxies, like Andromeda here. When we figure out distances to many other galaxies, we can find out how big the universe really is. I'd like to thank everyone who came to watch the presentation and the staff for a good weekend. Now, are there any questions? Yes, there's some formula, but it's very complicated.
I'd like to explain what a galaxy is, and it's pretty much a collection of stars and dust and gas all around each other by gravity. And it's usually a main ball in the center, as you can see, and it's usually a black hole in the center. And around that are disks, and then those disks are different star systems or clusters of stars. And galaxies are usually characterized by their shape. And the two main, or the two most common galaxies are the spiral and the elliptical. Spiral galaxies, their shape. So a spiral galaxy is shaped like a hurricane, and it has lots of stars with arms around it. Then there's the elliptical galaxy that it's named after the shape that it is in the ellipse. The shape can range from like a normal circle, or it can be elongated to look more like a cigar. And then there's the irregular galaxy, which doesn't really have any definite shape or form or anything like that. Kind of an overview of Andromeda. It's most famous for being the nearest galaxy. There's a bunch of other closer galaxies, but those are the sour galaxies and dwarf galaxies of Andromeda and the Milky Way. It's the most distant object you can see. It's the unaided eye. And that's because it's such a large galaxy and containing so many stars. And another reason why it's famous is because it's on a collision course, the Milky Way. And it's on the world of the Vegas. So the structure, it's shaped similar to the Milky Way because it's a spiral shape, hopefully called spiral shape. And it's got rotating arms around the center. And it has a bulge inside it with younger blue stars that are hotter. And the whole galaxy is about 220,000 light years across. And at the very center is a massive black hole that kind of keeps everything together. And that's believed to be true of all galaxies, that all galaxies have a black hole in the center. And altogether, Andromeda has about 300 trillion stars, or 1 trillion stars. And the Milky Way has about 300 billion stars. So that's about 3 times. Andromeda has about 3 times more stars. But it's suspected that the Milky Way has more mass because it has so much more dark matter in it. And the nucleus, originally the scientists thought that Andromeda had a double nucleus, that's because it was conceived. The light's different on one side compared to the other, and it kind of has like a peanut shape. And they expected that was because it formed, it was because the two galaxies came together to form Andromeda. But they kept the two nuclei, but they just combined their stars. But the center of Andromeda doesn't have two nuclei. It's just one elongated ellipse around the black hole. And so it has the black hole in the center, towards the upper left, and the nucleus up there. And then around that are two stars that are younger and hotter. And around that are two more rings of disks of older red stars. Andromeda is suspected to be formed 8 billion years ago from the formation of two smaller galaxies and from the combination of two smaller galaxies. And this collision is what formed the halo and the spiral arms, because when the two collided, there's like a spike in the star formation rate. But ever since then, it started to decrease. At one point, the star formation rate even almost stopped. From the side, it's starting to perk up again. New stars are being formed. So find the Andromeda galaxy, it's pretty easy. You look to the north sky and you find this W-shaped constellation Cassiopeia. And you notice that the ships are different sizes and different angles. So you take the bigger and the deeper dip and the sharper angle. And you kind of use that as an arrow point in Andromeda. The first time you look at Andromeda or want to find Andromeda, you should probably use binoculars or your naked eye. And then after you found it, you can zero in on it with the telescope. And this is Andromeda right here in the sky. It looks pretty much just a faint smudge of light. And I mentioned that collision course. Two galaxies that are coming closer together at 70 miles per second. The collision is expected to happen in 4 to 5 billion years. The collision can result in two ways. The two galaxies could either come together and form a new bigger galaxy, or they could resist the gravity of each other and they could continue on their own way. But it's more likely that the two will combine together. And you can see that there's a satellite galaxy with Andromeda here. That might come in the next year before the collision of Andromeda and the Milky Way. It's predicted that our solar system will kind of stay somewhat intact, but of course our sun will be a bit different, and we might just get thrown away from our original position, and we'll probably end up closer to the east. Okay. Any questions? So this is a zoom in of the nucleus, and one side of the nucleus is brighter than the other. You can see that. like, it's a lot brighter. It's like, there's a little production also. Well, we can study their paths that they get carried out, and we can use computers to predict the path that the tutor had made. So there's a bunch of computer simulations of how the tutor are going to climb.
Constellations in the northern sky. So Leo is also part of the summer zodiac and is generally associated with this zodiac symbol. I like Leo not because of the zodiac, but because of the resemblance of the real lion. As you can see in the image, the sickle part, which is this part up here, actually looks like the mane of a lion, of the real lion, and the rest of the constellation looks like the back of a lion. Leo is indeed a large constellation, thus making it easy to find. I also saw Leo at the planetarium at the beginning of camp, and we saw Leo in the sky at the first night we were here at camp. So, the early Mesopotamians were the first people to have a constellation like Leo. They had a constellation that resembled Leo as early as 4000 BC. The ancient Egyptians also used this constellation. The Egyptians liked this constellation because it meant that the annual flooding of the Nile River was approaching. The importance of the flood was to bring water to the Egyptians' crops so that they could survive. Ptolemy was the first person to catalog the stars in Leo. He also cataloged other zodiac constellations, and this is Ptolemy. Regulus is the brightest star in the constellation. It is a big red star, bigger than the sun. As it has an apparent magnitude of 1.35. Zosma, Denebola, and Algeba are other stars in the constellation. The meanings of the star names also have some importance. As you can see here, Denebola is at the tail of the constellation, one up. Algeba means the forehead, but it isn't at the forehead. But it is there near the head. You can also see the sickle that the mane is, and Regulus, the brightest star in the constellation. So on this one, I included deep sky objects in Leo. This is the galaxy M65, and this is NGC 3628, and those are galaxies that are found within the constellation Leo. And there's also a meteor shower every mid-November that seems to come from the direction of Leo. Leo the Lion is in the second quadrant of the northern hemisphere and can be seen at the latitudes between positive 90 degrees and negative 65 degrees. That's pretty much the whole world besides Antarctica. Leo can be found around here best in the spring, but Leo is still visible today. So, you may be asking, how do you find Leo? To find Leo, you first have to find the Big Dipper, which can be found in the northwestern sky. Then, following the pointer stars up and out of the Dipper to Polaris, you go down and out the bottom until you find Leo, which of course is the backwards question mark or symbol. Leo is actually quite easy to find. So, as you can see here, you have the Big Dipper and the arrow coming down, which I just put in to show Leo. So, as you can see, Leo the Lion is an interesting constellation. The constellation is interesting because it actually resembles a real lion. Also, the Mesopotamians were probably the first people with Leo as a constellation, and that was way back in 4000 BC. Then the Egyptians used the constellation to predict flooding for their crops. Also, Leo is part of the zodiac and is used in astrology. Thank you for watching. I would like to thank the camp staff for helping me by offering suggestions on my presentation. Are there any questions? Yes. I'm pretty sure Leo does have one, but I didn't actually research that. Right. I researched the actual constellation.
Okay.
Yes.
Is there any other ways we could find Leo?
Well, I guess if you found Polaris, you could go past the Big Dipper and down to Leo. But for me, the easiest way would be to use the Big Dipper and then just go down to Leo.
And then, does the meteor showers come out of Leo, or?
Well, it just appears to be coming from Leo, so I don't think it's coming out of Leo, but it's near there. Are there any other questions?
Thank you so much.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Jolie, and I'm fascinated by the weather on Mars. The weather on Mars is similar to weather here on Earth. It also has snow, dust storms, and lightning. So we have a bit more variety of what we can see meteorologically-wise. So what's in the atmosphere? I'm really glad we live on Earth because we have enough oxygen. Mars is not. It does have a lot of carbon dioxide, though. So what we breathe out is what carries the majority of on Mars. All right. Some other interesting things about the Martian atmosphere is that wind speeds are average at about 20 miles an hour. So that would be moderate breeze. The small trees would be swaying. It would feel nice. And, I'm glad we don't live on Mars. For another reason, it's awfully cold there. Average temperatures are negative 80 degrees Fahrenheit, so it's really cold. I just want to be the inside of something. So clouds on Mars are a lot like the Mare scales here on Earth. They're thin, kind of wispy, they're made out of water vapor. And these creatures are not showing up, so just thin and wispy. So snow on Mars is a lot like the diamond dust we get here on Earth. Diamond dust falls into the poles, and diamond dust is ice crystals instead of snowflakes. And so you wouldn't be able to make a snow Martian. Sorry. It sublimates quickly, so it skips the liquid state and goes from solid to gas. And it's frozen carbon dioxide, but I've also heard that it eats like water on Mars. So the dust storms on Mars. Mars gets dust devils, so these sort of dusty tornadoes. And they can form in a few hours. It engulf the planet in a few days, and in a matter of weeks, they can be lost. So they can go for a while there. Lightning on Mars looks like Earth's heat lightning, so you wouldn't see those bolts shooting across the sky. You'd see kind of a glow in the clouds. And we're not worried about this affecting any astronauts or the rovers. It would have to be directly overhead where they were working in order to affect any of the equipment. So, kind of as a recap here, Mars gets carbon dioxide and water snow.
You're distracting.
Carbon dioxide and water snow gets dust storms like you do here in the deserts, and it gets something like heat lightning, but not exactly. My citations. Can I answer any questions or comments?
The belly,
yes.
Course?
Okay. Well, I have two.
All right.
Okay, so is diamond dust made out of diamonds?
No, it's made out of water.
Okay, so it just gets like...
It kind of looks like this fog almost, I heard. I haven't seen it because I haven't been in the Earth's cold polar regions. So it's kind of sparkly.
It
looks
like diamonds. Okay. If we went to Mars, it'd be like, when why did you comment on that?
Yes.
Like,
you would not last long on Mars. Yes?
I wanted to ask, how does it escape from the solid?
I don't really know the answer to that. I'm sorry. Like dry ice. You know how you get dry ice and you leave it sitting out on a table and it doesn't melt and turn into liquid, it just immediately goes into the gas and releases itself into the room. So yeah, the same thing happens on Mars. Do you have any questions?
With the weather on Mars, how does it go through the weather if things like don't sound or anything?
There are clouds on Mars. They're
just kind of wispy.
Yes, Grant.
How do they know what the weather's like on Mars? From those rovers?
From the rovers, and they've also sent satellites that are orbiting the red planet.
Oh.
You know, and if they're taking images, you know. They're finding out that Mars has about 4 layers in an atmosphere compared to our 5 layers in an atmosphere.
Alright.
Any other questions?
Alright, well thank you very much.
Okay.
So
Yeah. Look at how cold Mars was. It froze.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Hey. Well, welcome to all of our wonderful presentations. I'm Angela Newman, and I decided to do mine on Saturn's rings, just Saturn's rings, because there's so much about them. Like, yeah, that was a whole PowerPoint about them, obviously. Okay. So, starting with the facts. Saturn's rings were first discovered by Christian Huygens in 1655. The rings are actually made up of water ice with trace amounts of like silicate and other different materials. And as you can see, they're actually named A through G, but they don't go in order of the alphabet. They're actually named in the order they were discovered. And I'm only naming the major rings because there's so many rings and that would be like forever and ever. Okay. There's divisions in the rings, and the biggest division is the Cassini division, and it is the biggest of all gaps because there's so many gaps in these rings, and I'll explain how that happens. It's really, really cool. The Cassini division is named after Giovanni Cassini, and he was an Italian astronomer, and we actually had something in common. We both liked pizza, so that's good. Gaps, actually, if you look at Saturn in a telescope or you have pictures of Saturn, you will see this big gap, and that is the Cassini division. And it actually looks like it's just like transparent, but there's actually materials in there that you can't see because it's just like little tiny floating things. And Cassini was formed by the moon Venus, and I'll explain how that happened. So the gaps actually form from gravity of the moons because Saturn actually has like 62 moons, and a lot of them have a gravitational pull. And this gravitational pull will pull materials out of the rings. And I have a video that's actually really cool to watch. This is the F ring, and there's Pandora on the left, which is the moon, and Prometheus on the right. This is a really cool video. It's like sweet, like they just like pull stuff out. Pretty intense. Okay, so as you can see, this is Pandora. Oh, I'm going to reset this thing. Actually, you can see the particles that these moons are pulling out, creating this gap. Okay, so as the moons come, you can actually see these little ripples if you look really closely. That is actually like dust particles and everything coming out, and that's creating the gaps that we see between Saturn's rings. And it's actually how strong those gravitational pulls are. It's pretty cool. Like, it's just cool. So each revolution around Saturn's rings that the moons take, the moon will pull a little more out, and after time you will see what the Cassini division is. Now the rings. Okay, how the rings form. Saturn Saturn's rings, as I said, are made up of ice, dust, and particles in space. The gravity of the planet has made it possible for the rings, and also the gravity of the moon. So the gravity of the planet pulls the stuff in. It, when like things get too close, like asteroids and comets and dust and everything in space, it'll just kind of sit there and go around Saturn. And so the rings, to make it possible to see the rings, the light from space and the sun mostly will reflect off of those rings, making it visible. That's how you can see so many rings around Saturn. A common theory is also how the material got there, is that when things crash into the moons, it'll just kind of disperse and there'll be like debris and everything, and that will also be too close, and you'll get a ring after over time of things hitting the moons and just deflecting off. So there's the first major ring, which is ring A. It's one of the most visible rings of Saturn, and between it would be the Cassini division. So here's ring A and ring B, and then there's Cassini division. So there's the first ring. Ring B would be next to ring A. It's actually one that's in order. A, B, and C are in order, but the rest are kind of just like everywhere. It is one of the largest and brightest and the most dense of all the rings. And it's called the mysterious ring because we haven't really figured out what all is in this ring. Like, we can pretty much tell what's in the other rings, but this one kind of has unidentified things floating in it that we don't know what they are. So they call it the mysterious ring. And there's no gaps and no moons in it. So it's just like a straight ring. There's nothing in it. It's just mysterious. Ring C would be after, and ring C is right here. And there's a gap right there dividing. It's a very, very faint ring, and it's also called the crep ring because it's darker material than the brighter A and B rings, so it's like scary and creepy, so they named it crepe. And it was actually first discovered in 1850, and it was sought independently by William R. Dowes. And there's four rings left, and they're just called the dusty rings because they're so faint you can barely see them. They're not one of the like major A, B, C. This is where it gets like all over Saturn. The D ring is the innermost, and it was first seen in the gap between C rings. So it was like, it's in between, it's in the gap, in one of the gaps in C ring. And it was found during Saturn's 2009 equinox by a Cassini spacecraft. It is extremely faint. As you can see, this is the B ring, and up here you see the brighter, that's the C ring. And you can see the difference between how bright and light each one of them are. Next is the E ring, and it's the second outermost and extremely wide. And it is between the moons Mimas and Rhea. So you can see one of the moons right here. This is actually like a water moon. You can actually kind of see the water. It's of the water world. And F ring, which is the most active, and you might be wondering, like, what does active mean? Rings can't move. But every hour you would look at it, it would change some kind of characteristic. It's one of the most active out there. And so, like, you can see it at 1 hour. If you had, like, extremely good eyes, you wouldn't be able to see it. But it does change, like, every hour, a characteristic some type. And it's between the Prometheus and Pandora. And it's here, right here. It's outermost. It's really small. It's the one that we saw being pulled from the moons. And then there's the G ring. It's also a thin and very faint ring. And it's about halfway between the F ring. So you can see the G ring, and then the F ring goes out here, but the F ring is still here. So it's like between them. And it's hardly considered because it's so small and faint and faint. Questions?
All right, from Valley, of course. Of course.
I have two. So, okay. So the ring, I'm talking the previous ring, so it has all this.
Yes.
So we don't really know what's in there. So there's no rocks or anything. It's like gas.
We don't know. We know there's the ice and particles because that's what the rings are made of. But there's also things that we have seen and we can't really wrap our mind around that we don't know. So it's just called the mysterious ring.
Okay. Okay, so was your guy, like, the guy you were talking about was, like, Italian, and the other guy was French, maybe? Like, Quake and, Crank. Colorado or whatever.
Different people discover
different
things.
Are you done?
Yeah, I'm done.
Okay. Okay. Oh, I love you. What was it? I'm sorry. Okay, so crap. Is that like the actual word for thinking? Or
no, crank.
It's
crank.
It's crank.
Yummy.
Well, I know. It's a French word for like dark and
yummy.
Okay. Oh,
I guess they're also pancakes too, but
I don't think that's a lot of time to talk about.
Would you guys?
Alright, any other questions for anyone? Alright, thank you very much.
My name is Angela, and I decided to do my presentation on Saturn. I wanted to know in there that this picture you see was taken by Jeff Brush, one of our staffs, and I had edited the photo to make it more clear, although you can't see it very well. Okay, so some of the basics of Saturn. It is the sixth planet from the sun. It is the second largest planet. It was named after the Roman god of agriculture. It is a gas planet. Its radius is 9 times that of the Earth. And its density is 1/8 the average density of the Earth, and it is 95 times more massive than the Earth. So the size of it, you can tell, like, that's just the rings of Saturn compared to the Earth. And then that's Saturn here compared to some of the other planets around the area. And then there's Saturn compared to the Earth. So, although it has a solid core, the exterior is composed of gas and it lacks a definite surface. It is the only planet in the solar system that is less dense than water, and it is 30% less dense than water. So some of the layers, you can see that down here, down in the bottom in the core, you've got the liquid and the metallic hydrogen. And then in the intermediate layer, you got the liquid hydrogen. And then you got the outer, which is the ice and the helium and the gas layer, gaseous layer. And then there's a better spherical diagram. So the planet, you can see a pale yellow color due to the ammonia crystals in the atmosphere, and also due to the ammonium hydrosulfide in the atmosphere as well, in the lower levels. So some of the weather patterns is the temperature ranges between 250 degrees Celsius and 70 degrees Celsius. and the wind speeds can reach up to 1,800 kilometers an hour, or 1,000 miles per hour. So some of the cloud patterns, we got the hexagonal cloud pattern that's on the North Pole. It was first noticed by Voyager, and it is located at 78 degrees north. It was noticed by the, also by Cassini. And each side measures up to 13,800 kilometers. And it, there are still many unknown variables because it was just discovered in April. So they're still trying to find some things out about it. So some of the rings, it's one of the most extensive planetary ring system in the solar system. It consists of small particles that range between micrometers and meters. And there's water and ice with some components of rocky material. So some things about the gaps. There are two that are opened by the moons that are embedded in them. And there are many others in the orbital resonances within the Saturn's moons. So some things about the moons. They have 62 moons, and Titan is the largest, and you can see Titan right there. And then there's like a lot of moons, so I didn't want to get into too much detail about that. So any questions? Karan?
So you won't be able to walk on it.
Probably, yes. You probably get like stuff that's very popular.
So, anybody else?
Anyone else have any questions?
Thank you very much.
Can have a mass that is equivalent to billions of our sun, and stellar black holes, which form when a massive star collapses, which And then last but not least, there is a miniature black hole, which have a mass that is much smaller than our sun. Okay. So when a black hole is born, it has to go through a process called a supernova. A supernova is when a supergiant blows up and like the star collapses on itself. That's when the matter becomes so dense it turns into a black hole. And so right here, like it's the center of that supergiant where it blows up and then it becomes big, and then once like the pressure, like both once like the bombs go like off it and it dies. Pressure like collapses on itself, which turns into a supernova, and then it will either turn have an example, and it's like, think about a person going kayaking, and they go towards a waterfall. The water has so much force that it pulls you under. It, that's a lot like a black hole, but the black holes, of course, have more force and could pull in other stuff. So, how scientists know they're there. Black holes cannot be directly observed because you know, it's invisible, but you can see a star going into the black hole, because as gas falls into a black hole, like coming from a nearby star, the gas will heat up and glow, becoming visible by X-rays. And fun facts. Nothing can come out. Once you're in a black hole, you can't come out. And then the clock near a black hole appearing to tick more slowly is then like, because when you're distant to a black hole, like time goes really slow. And then the event horizon is the point outside the black hole where the gravitational attraction becomes so strong that the escape velocity is the same speed of light. And then growth. Once a black hole is formed, it can continue to grow by absorbing additional matter. Any questions?
What do you know how black holes are formed?
I guess it's just like a theory. Like, you know, how everything else is.
Yeah.
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 Well, it will take a long time for it to disappear. But I don't think, like, it's either, like, yeah.
Okay, so, you said how you can't get out of a black hole.
Yeah.
So if you got into a black hole, would you like, would it like crush you, or would you just like keep swimming inside the black hole?
That's actually a really good question, but nobody really knows that. Like, they have a lot of, like, all these people have, like, a lot of theories, like, if you die or something, or it goes, like, yeah. So, there's a lot of different
things. That was your question, you all want to know what happens when you're inside the black
hole? No one really knows. Else? Okay, thank you very much. Libby's next.
Yes.
She will be discussing the Whirlpool Galaxy. More to shine.
Is this a teacher again?
Charles Messier, which is this guy, the first discovered it. And then that was in 1973.
but its outstanding solid structure was first persevered by William Parsons. In 1845, using his huge reflecting telescope, of Parsons Town, a large telescope was needed to see its intricate shape, but even smaller amateur telescopes reveal that this galaxy is not isolated, but has a small companion, the dwarf neighborhood galaxy, NGC 500. How to spot a dwarf galaxy? You, how to spot it is you follow the handle into the handle, and you take it and you go southwest. Properties of the SC cloud spotting. It has small bulge. Lizzy wound, bright blue spiral. That's supposed to be blue back there. Moderately high star emission rate. Black holes. It has surrounded black holes like in the middle. Okay. And it's by a ring of dust. It is thought to exist at the heart of a spiral. The dust ring stands almost perpendicular to the irregular flat spiral nebula. The secondary ring crosses the primary ring on a different axis at a phenomenon that is contrary to the companion galaxy is irregular, unstructured in shape, which is this right here. And it's collided with the M51 twice for the past 500 million years. And the effects of the collision enhance spiral structure and expose galaxies.
Favorite planets. Okay.
gravitation, ways to get to outer space, and characteristics of gravitation. We're going to be following the schedule, so it's close to it. My introduction. The planets that I chose is Mercury, Mars, and Venus. And on my next slide, I'm going to do the ways to get to space. You can get to space by spacecraft, shuttles, the Russian shuttle program, the U.S. shuttle program. They didn't get funded anymore, so they closed down, and now we use the Russian rocket program. The space probes, they're different than the spacecraft. The spacecraft probes, the space probes, they're for tanks. Then you do rocket launches by, that's how you use these things, like rocket launches. Space flight became an engineering possibility with Robert H. Goddard in the 20th century. Okay. You can research space by rovers, shuttles, weather balloons, telescopes, and weapons. So, this picture right here, these are the different levels of space. So this is the atmosphere. Planes fly this high, 6 kilometers, and this is our atmosphere. This is how high, so this is how high planes can fly. The stratosphere, this is how high they can fly. People used to think that the stratosphere would go higher, but it actually goes to the mesosphere where meters go to high. This is the aurora, the hydrogen program. This is the photosphere. This is the solar side. It's the exosphere. And that you can get really dark up there. My new and improved direction. So this is over here. This is the telescope on the year. We talked about telescopes for robot classes. So to make my telescope, this is the Jupiter plus the right there, and then this is times two, and so magnified times two, so we'll make it 100 magnification. This is the core computer, this is the scanning computer, and the color film. So if you have a black and white camera, it puts color in it, and that will just get a little bit pink goes with everything.
She's valid.
So, the planets I chose, Mercury is the closest planet to the sun. It orbits this high, and it's compared to by other planets, it's the smallest. So we can. This is Mercury. It shows you the parts of the magnet. And these, like little circles, those are the magnetic fields. It's pushing this way because the sun, it has energy, and it's pretty catching. Is that this goes up from New York. And there's this one goes this way, and this one just goes up from New York. And it can get up to 360 centimeters of mercury. See, it heats up to 10,000 more, so the pressure and the energy of the sun is not such a thing that makes it that very close. Okay, so my other plan I chose is Mars. Mars has the largest volcanoes and the largest canyons. It's the only planet told to support life. And it has two moons, Fomos is here and Fomos is there. This is the volcano that is listed for the This is Mars by the sun. I would call it a Mars. Venus is the second planet from the temperature at Venus is 462 Celsius, and Venus has no lunar reflection. This is a picture of Venus. Okay, so this is a replay. This is a joke up there because there's a rebound button. It looks like a question. Thank you for participating in our presentation. Questions after?
Set of cards, and in these cards, there are four aces. You guys to draw a card. I'm going to come by, you pick a card.
That'll
be interesting.
A good way to get out of giving you guys presents.
Jeez, sorry.
Oh, come on!
Come on!
Oh,
yeah.
So those of you who draw a red ace, you're gonna get to choose. Come up here and pick between these two games. No fist fights. These two games that were out on the tables that you were playing. Some of you got really good at set. Some of you were really good at blink. And so these games are up here. If you draw a black ace, you get a copy of this book. This book was written by a guy who's been to the moon, an Apollo astronaut, one of the very few people who's actually been to the moon. His name was Colonel Al Warden, and what makes him extra special is he's from here. He's from Jackson. So, and to make matters more interesting, we got him to sign the books. So if you have a black ace, you can come up and get a copy of the book. If you have a red ace, you can come up and get a game. But the good news is we're going to have something for everybody.
There's a parting gift, yes. So what we've done is we've recorded all of these sessions. And I'm going to put them on a DVD, and I'll send them to your parents, or if you want to send them to your parents, so you can see your presentation in all its glory. You can show all your friends how exciting this was. Another thing I want to say is Steve Tuckey and I put on a math and science conference every year at Jackson College, and we bring that and astronauts and a bunch of other interested individuals from the community. And if you guys are interested, you can come and participate by presenting on something of interest that you work on throughout the year. It is a real scientific conference, so you'll be in front of 50 or 100 people presenting on your ideas. So it's something that you want to think about. If you are interested, contact Steve or I or teachers in your classroom that you maybe that would like to work with you. And then we can bring you on over and you can talk about what you're interested in.
How do we get that contact information?
Definitely through the ISD.
Yeah, the ISD will definitely.
Because my daughter got invited to the Michigan Space Consortium last year, and this would be a really good thing to be able to put her in front of people. She just got to attend last year, but this would be a really great way to do it.
Yeah, the ISD, Luana, how the students ended up in this camp, just contact Luana and she'll contact us.
Or you can be contacted.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mark runs the planetarium in Jackson. That's where you guys started off at the planetarium. The Hearst Planetarium in Jackson, Mark's in charge. He's kind of a big deal. So you've got an inside guy at the planetarium if you want to contact him.
I was going to say,
you can put something on her phone during that or if you want to know.
Okay.
We have a newsletter that's called Constant Contact.
Okay.
So it's another way to subscribe, like, please send me an email and subscribe.
Okay.
So, I did want to say, so if you get the astronaut books,
yeah.
Albert, I'm graduating from Jackson High School. And he was on board Apollo 13. His job was to fly around the moon. So he's a pretty cool guy talking about growing up in
Jackson.
I missed that. I'll tell you about it.
Okay, and very last but not least, you guys have your flash drives over here, and on the flash drives, all the things that you saved, those are yours to keep along with your presentation that's on there. So make sure that you come up. You've got them all up here, and they're all labeled, so you can grab yours. Make sure you grab your flash drive. And you got your certificate, and now you can't get that $20.
Oh, yeah, we got your $20. All right.